Welcome to Introduction to Arc Length by Conceptual Calculus. This video is part of a series on applications of the integral. In this video, we learn how to use a definite integral to find the exact arc length of a curve described by a given function. Before we get into our main topic, we need a brief review of the Mean Value Theorem. You probably saw this in Calculus 1, although you may not remember it very well. We start with the graph of a function, y equals f of x. We select two points on the function, x equals a and x equals b, and draw a straight line through those two points of the curve. The Mean Value Theorem says that as long as the derivative of the function exists on the interval between x equals a and x equals b, then there is some point between x equals a and x equals b at which the slope of the line tangent to the curve is equal to the slope of the line through the endpoints. The x-coordinate at this point is sometimes called x star. To put that in symbols, the slope of the line through the two endpoints is rise over run, which is change in y over change in x. We often use the Greek letter delta to represent a change or a difference, so we can write change in y over change in x as delta y over delta x. We can calculate that by subtracting the y values at the two ends and dividing that by the difference between the x values at the two ends. The slope of the tangent line is the derivative of the function f, which we write f prime of x. At the point x star, those two slopes are equal. Here is another example. We have a curve and two endpoints. The curve is differentiable between those points, so the Mean Value Theorem says there is at least one point on the curve where the tangent line has the same slope as the line between the two endpoints. In this case, there are two points where the tangent line has that slope. The Mean Value Theorem does not say how many such points the function will have. The theorem simply guarantees that there will be at least one. Now, on to our main question, how to find the arc length of a curve. We start with a simple curve, with a length that is easy to find, a straight line segment. We form a right triangle with the given segment as its hypotenuse. The vertical and horizontal sides are the legs of the right triangle. The change in x from one end of the segment to the other is delta x. In this example, delta x is 6. The change in y from one end of the segment to the other is delta y. In this example, delta y is 3. The distance measured along the diagonal can be called delta s. In calculus, we often use the letter s to represent distance because the letter d has so many other jobs to do. We use the Pythagorean theorem, a squared plus b squared equals c squared, which gives us delta x squared plus delta y squared equals delta s squared. So delta s is the square root of delta x squared plus delta y squared. Notice that this is not the same as delta x plus delta y. Using the numbers of this problem, we find that delta s is the square root of 6 squared plus 3 squared, which is 36 plus 9, or 45. Thus, delta s is the square root of 45. This can be simplified as 3 times the square root of 5, which is about 6.7. That means this segment is 6.7 units long. Now consider the curve y equals f of x equals 1/4 x squared minus x plus 2 from x equals 0 to x equals 6. We want the arc length of this curve. If we think of the curve as a piece of string, we want to know how long the string would be if we could stretch it out straight. Whenever possible, we always start with an estimate. The simplest estimate for the length of a curve comes from the straight line distance between the endpoints of the curve. The straight segment has delta x equal to 6 and delta y equal to 3, so the length of the diagonal segment is 3 square root 5, or about 6.7 units. A straight segment is always the shortest path between two points, so we know the curve is longer than 6.7 units. Imagining the curve as a piece of string, I don't think the string could stretch all the way from one endpoint to the other and back again. So I think the length of the curve is less than twice the length of the segment. From this, I conclude that the length of the curve is definitely more than 6.7 and probably less than 13.4 units. The curve is more complicated than a straight line segment because the curve is not straight. Another way of saying that is that its slope is not constant. The slope is shallower on the left and steeper on the right. If only the slope were constant, making the curve straight, then the length would be very simple to find. The problem is more complicated because the slope is varying. That is an indication that integration could be helpful here. We break the curve up into several parts and approximate each part with a straight segment. This solves the problem of the varying slope. For each individual segment, the slope is constant. I'm starting with only two segments, each with the same value of delta x. The segment on the left has delta x equal to 3 and delta y equal to negative 0.75, because y goes down as we move to the right. This means the length, delta s, is about 3.1 units. The segment on the right also has delta x equal to 3 and has delta y equal to positive 3.75, so its length is about 4.8 units. Combining those, we get a total length of 3.1 plus 4.8 equals 7.9 units. As expected, this is longer than the straight line distance of 6.7 units. It is still a little shorter than the length of the curve, though. For each of the two segments, the straight segment is still the shortest path between the endpoints, so the curve is a little longer. Now look at what happens if we make the segment shorter and use more of them. As the segments become shorter, they follow the curve more closely. In the limit, as the length of each segment approaches zero, so that the number of segments approaches infinity, the segments follow the curve perfectly. In the limit, as the length of a segment approaches zero, the sum of the lengths of all the segments is exactly equal to the arc length of the curve. To set up the integral, we start by understanding one segment very well. Then we can add them up. We need some way to keep track of which specific segment we're talking about. We want a variable that can serve as a unique identifier, sort of like the address of the segment. Y does not work for this, because we can have more than one segment with the same values of y. For example, the left and middle segments in this sketch both have ends at y equals 2 and y equals 1. This means we can't use the y coordinates to identify the individual segments. We can use the x coordinates, though. No two segments have the same values of x. I'm going to identify each segment by the value of x at the point guaranteed by the Mean Value Theorem, where the slope of the tangent line is equal to the slope of a line through the two ends of the segment. The theorem guarantees that at least one such point will exist on each segment. If there are multiple points, we can use any one of them. Because the variable x keeps track of which segment we are talking about, x is the variable of integration. Everything we do will have to be written in terms of x. In these problems, we always break a large thing up into small parts, and there is always some dimension that is very small, approaching zero in the limit. In this case, that is the horizontal dimension of the segment. This dimension approaches zero as we use a larger number of segments. As we move from the left end of a segment to the right end of the same segment, we go a little bit forward along the x-axis. If we are talking about a finite number of segments, each with a finite length, then we call this width delta x. When we talk about an infinite number of segments, with the horizontal dimension approaching zero, then we will call this width dx. Now that we have a notation for the way the curve is broken up into segments, we need to remind ourselves of what we are trying to find. We want the arc length of the curve, which we are going to find by adding up the lengths of the short segments. So, we need the length of one segment. For the length of a segment, we go back to the Pythagorean theorem, which gave us the equation delta s equals the square root of delta x squared plus delta y squared. Because the variable of integration is x, we need to write delta y in terms of x. For that, we use the slope. The slope of the segment is delta y over delta x. The slope of the tangent line comes from the derivative, so it is f prime of x. At the point where x equals x star, those are equal. This gives us the equation delta y over delta x equals f prime of x star. Multiplying through by the denominator, we get delta y equals f prime of x star multiplied by delta x. Now we can use that to get the length of a segment in terms of x only, with no y's. We go back to our equation, delta s equals the square root of delta x squared plus delta y squared. Replace delta y with f prime of x star times delta x. We can factor out the delta x squared and pull it out of the radical. This gives the length of one finite segment. If we are considering the limit as delta x approaches 0, then we use dx instead of delta x. We can also drop the star from the x. With the length of a segment approaching 0, each segment dwindles down to only one point, so we don't have to fuss about which point in the segment we're talking about. This gives us ds equals the square root of 1 plus f prime of x squared with a dx outside the radical. Now we have the parts we need to assemble our integral. The length of one short segment is the square root of 1 plus f prime of x squared times dx. To add the lengths of the segments together, we integrate. Our variable of integration is x, so the limits of integration must be values of x. The leftmost short segment has x equals 0, and the rightmost one has x equals 6, so we integrate from 0 to 6. Now that we have set up the integral, we can evaluate it. We have the integral of the square root of 1 plus f prime of x squared dx from x equals 0 to x equals 6. Our function is f of x equals 1/4 x squared minus x plus 2. So its derivative is 1/2 x minus 1. We square that and get 1/4 x squared minus x plus 1. Then we add 1 to that, which gives 1/4 x squared minus x plus 2. It is just a coincidence that this matches our original function. With a different original function, it wouldn't match. We put that under a radical and integrate it from x equals 0 to x equals 6. This is a mess. At the point in many calculus courses when arc length is introduced, we do not yet know how to evaluate this integral. You may be able to evaluate it on your calculator. I'm going to use Wolfram Alpha. Wolfram Alpha gives us a result of 8.2114. This is the arc length of the curve. Compare this to the estimate. We determined that the arc length was definitely more than 6.7 and appeared to be less than 13.4. A length of 8.21 fits that description. When our calculation agrees with our estimate, we can have more confidence in our results. In a later video, we will consider a different example curve, which will give us an integral that we can evaluate using basic integration techniques that you probably already know. The price we will pay for the simple calculus is some really messy algebra, but we'll survive it. Thank you for watching Introduction to Arc Length by Conceptual Calculus.